I'm going to talk a little bit about the social class to which you and I belong. I think sometimes if I was born 100 years from now and I was a historian writing about our times, how would I describe India, the India that we live in today? And I think the most striking feature of the India that I see around is a country in which people of privilege have developed an extraordinary degree of indifference to suffering and inequality around them. And I think that is what most defines to me the country that I live in. Noam Chomsky, a well-known public intellectual, visited Delhi a couple of years ago, and in an interview he said he'd never seen a country where poverty is so dramatically manifest in the face as India. But he's also never seen a country where people have developed such a strong capacity to see and look away. It's not the facts of growing inequality that trouble me so much. It is a normative framework in which we have come to believe that this inequality is either inevitable or even justified. I teach a course at the IIM Ahmedabad once a year and on poverty and governance. And when I enter my class, the first thing I try to tell my students is that none of you nor I are in this room, and I would say that probably to the people in this audience as well. None of us are in this room because we are the best. Because if a billion people in our country had the same life chances as you and I had, I wouldn't be here. And most of us would have to decide whether we would have been in the places that we have achieved. But the trouble is that most of us mistake privilege for merit and for entitlement. We believe that we have got where we are because we are the best. We have the merit. We have worked hard. When the food bill was being discussed a couple of years ago, in television debates, I found that the entire audience, the entire panel was furious, often including the anchor. I remember one industrialist turned to me and said, "I worked hard. I made my money. What's wrong with it? I've worked hard to earn my money. I've done nothing to harm the economy. Why should I be taxed to feed the poor?" And I think that's at the heart of what I want to talk about. I had to answer to her. I said that you would agree that the poor work hard, much, much harder. They've done much less to harm the economy. And in a good society, people of wealth should be happy to share some of it with the poor. But we've constructed a society, we built a world around us where, in Arundhati Roy's description, she said there's been only one successful secession movement in India: secession of the middle class from the rest of India. We've created our own gated colonies, separate schools, our malls where we shop, expensive cinemas where we go to. And the only poor people we actually encounter in our lives today are people whose job is to serve us. And we forget their full humanness in one sense. And so when I put my child to bed at night, it's a cold winter night, I've given her everything that money can buy. I've given her care, I've given her protection, I've given her the best education, the best food. And when I tuck her into bed at night, it doesn't worry me that for even a fraction of a moment, that outside, maybe a kilometer away, is another little girl, just my daughter's age, who would have, found her food in a waste heap somewhere. She'd spend the night worried that she'd perhaps be raped through the night. She'd wake up in the morning and start, waking up at 4 and looking for trash. She'll never see the inside of a school. The fact that it doesn't worry us for a single moment is what worries me most. And I think that, you know, that 1 kilometer that separates me from my child from that child becomes the longest distance in the world. And the absence of outrage about this difference, that the only difference between my child and that child is that that child didn't choose her parents as wisely as my child did, or your children did. There's nothing else, nothing that is else is different. And yet where this child is born determines still today the rest of her life, whether she'll have an education, what kind of education. We talk about aspirational young people. And there are many young people in the audience here. Do you even know how many young people in this country complete college? About 7%. Girls, about 4%. People in rural areas, about 2%. And this is any kind of college. So what is life like for the rest of the young populations that we have? So if you're a girl, median age, you'd probably be married at the age of 16, dropped out of school, you'll have 2 underweight children by the age of 18, you'll be defecating in the open, you'll have no menstrual protection. If you're a boy, you know, again about the same age, you wouldn't be married, but you'd soon become almost the principal bread earner. You'll have to go out somewhere looking for a way of surviving. And I think it is this enormous gap between these two worlds that have only grown and which do not cause us any kind of outrage. I, again, teaching a course in my old college in St. Stephen's, I was speaking with young people and I said, just to start a conversation, I said, how many of you been inside a slum? And 0 hands went up. So I got a little startled. I said, okay, how many of you have at least seen a slum? And less than half the hands went up. And I realized that you cannot live in Delhi and actually not see a slum every day. But the fact that it doesn't even register to you. And we start learning inequality and we teach that to our children in many different ways. Look at the way we treat our domestic help. I mean, a child of 4, parents will say, son, touch the feet of all the elders. How does he learn at the age of 4 that the elders don't include the domestic help? That here is an adult that I can treat, talk to rudely, I can command. And so the injustices of our world are something that don't cause us grief and suffering and outrage. Akhil Gupta is an anthropologist and he tried to calculate how many people die in India every year of completely avoidable causes. They don't have enough clean drinking water or food. Or healthcare, and he came up with a figure of 2 million. To put that figure in perspective, the number of people who died in the Great Bengal Famine of 1943 was 3 million. So what we are really seeing is something like the Great Bengal Famine playing out, invisibly among us, and it's not an issue. And I think that many things have broken down. Amartya Sen, in his book, The Idea of Justice, towards the end, asks a very interesting question. He says that injustice has characterized every human society through history and through the world. But something else has also characterized human society, and that is resistance to this injustice. And he asks, why, what is it that makes resistance to injustice universal to the human experience? And he says there are 3 things in human nature. The first of them is the quality of empathy. The second, he says, is the capacity to reason. And the third, he says, is the love of freedom. But here, let me just talk about that quality of empathy. To me, empathy is first an act of imagination. You have to imagine what it would be like. So just talking about homeless people only, because they're people you see every day and we look away. I remember the first homeless shelter that we had set up for homeless women in Delhi. I asked them, what's changed most in your lives? And they said, for the first time, one of the women said, for the first time in 17 years, when I close my eyes at night, I'm sure that no one will rape me, through the night. And, you know, as a man, I perhaps will never be able to have empathy enough to understand what being raped is. But even for a woman, I mean, one such episode will scar you for life. Imagine a life where there's nothing that you can do about it for 17 years. What would life look like to you? I think the capacity even to imagine that distance and what it would be to live as somebody who is born in a different place, who suffers different kinds of really difficult challenges to life, and the inequality of childhoods that separate us, I think is something that needs to, the quality of public compassion has to be the starting point in a larger battle of solidarity to fight injustice. And I think it is that quality of public compassion, the quality of solidarity, the quality of belonging to each other. Again, you know, ending with Noam Chomsky, he said, what is social protection? And he answered that social protection is basically the idea that we should take care of each other. Simply the idea that we should take care of each other. However, we live in times where this idea that we should just take care of each other is seen increasingly as an extremely dangerous idea, a subversive idea that needs to be crushed at all costs. And I think it is this idea of public compassion that we need to claim and make our own. The conversations that we have with young people have to change. The way we look at our own privilege has to change. And our comfort with suffering and injustice has to change. Only then will India change. Thank you.